Stingrays, sharks in disguise. Welcome back to Shelby on Safari, and in today's video, we are going to answer just that by seeing what rays and sharks have in common, as well as what makes rays so unique. And in fact, in honor of Father's Day, I'm going to tell you about a cool dance move my dad taught me from a very young age with regards to stingrays. And stay tuned to the end because I'm going to introduce you to one crazy cool animal that you have to see to believe. So you ready? Join the safari and let's dive right in. So first up, what do rays and sharks actually have in common? Well, it turns out more than you might think. They're in the class Contradicthes, which is not contradictory. That is the class of cartilaginous fish, or fish that have cartilage instead of bones. But the relationship goes a little bit further into the subclassification Elasmobranchii, which includes sharks, rays, and skates. Within this subclassification, there are a few cool things that they have in common, like nearly a 360-degree field of vision with well-developed eyes. They have a tapetum lucidum, which essentially is a fancy word, and it's also quite fun to say, for a reflective layer that sits behind the retina. So when light comes in, light bounces off the tapetum lucidum and improves the animal's sensitivity, if you will, in low light situations. Essentially, they can see better. And you may know that some cats' eyes seem to glow in the dark, as well as a few other mammals. Well, that's what they have as well. Sadly, us humans don't, although I wish I did. That'd be quite cool. And while we're talking about vision, no, not that vision. That's for another video. Sharks, rays, and skates can actually see in color as well. And while their vision may sound impressive, which it is, they do actually lack something. A swim bladder. So how do sharks, rays, and skates regulate their buoyancy in the water? Well, there's a few different ways, but probably the most well-known is, well, their liver. Yep, that's right, their liver. They have large livers relative to their body size that are filled with a low-density oil, the main component of which is squalene. Now, squalene is surprisingly found in a variety of different products, some of which may be in your own home. I recently found out more about this over on my buddy Grace's channel, which, by the way, I'll put a link to that specific video in the description down below so you can check it out after this one. So another thing that helps them stay buoyant is, of course, their lightweight skeleton. Remember, this isn't a skeleton that's made out of bones. Oh no. It's made out of cartilage. Remember that was that fun word in the very beginning? That's like contradictory, but not chondrichthyes. And the fun words don't stop there, my friends. Another thing that rays and sharks have in common, in fact, quite a few other animals as well, are specialized gel-filled pit organs that are known as the Ampullae of Lorenzini. These were first described way back in 1697 by the Italian physician Stefano Lorenzini. It's these Ampullae of Lorenzini that enable them to detect electrical fields that are emitted when, say, other living creatures contract a muscle, like a heartbeat. Isn't that so cool? Adaptation to have, but also a really cool name to say. Ampullae of Lorenzini. Go on, you try saying it. It's really fun. All right, so we covered some things that sharks and rays have in common. But what makes stingrays so unique? Apart from the obvious, their pretty impressive tail, which of course we'll get to. Well, remember those classifications that we went through earlier? Well, if we go one step further down into the superorder Barodiae, this has over 500 different species of rays and skates. Some are as small as 4 inches, while others get up to 20 feet in length. And within that, not all rays swim the same way. Some flap in a bird-like motion, and others contort their entire bodies to glide through the water. And as someone who was a swim teacher for many years, I certainly wouldn't have to teach baby rays how to swim. They are born fully formed and ready to go right off the bat. No pun intended there with bat ray, but it should have been a pun intended. Now, stingrays are the largest members of the ray family. And of course, there's always one exception in nature, isn't there? Or a handful. It turns out not every stingray does, in fact, have a sting. Take, for example, the ever-impressive manta ray. They are the largest ray and get over 2,000 pounds.
Whoa!
Now, many stingrays are bottom dwellers, and so they need a way to, well, protect themselves from predators. And what better way than with a really impressive sting? So a shark swimming above notices a stingray, tries to go in for it, and the stingray will defend itself. They are exceptionally quick when it comes to defending themselves. Goes to show that, well, they've had a lot of time to become quite specialized with what they do. In fact, rays have been around for over 150 million years, since the Jurassic period. Isn't that nuts? But anyways, back to the stinging. That is, in fact, the dance move that my dad taught me from a very young age. It turns out my local beach growing up was quite the stingray hangout as well. And so whenever entering or leaving the water in the shallows of the beach, he would teach me to do the stingray shuffle. Easy to do, easy to remember, and in fact, over the many years, not to age myself or anything, I'm very fortunate enough to have never been stung by a stingray. Knock on wood. And that's because the stingray shuffle is literally just shuffling your feet along the ocean floor. We'll find out next why this tends to let stingrays know that you're on the way. As I mentioned, a lot of species of stingray tend to be bottom dwellers, burying themselves underneath the sand. In fact, they're quite the masters of camouflage. Not nearly as expert-like as my friend the mimic octopus, but still impressive nonetheless. Because some species can change the color and the pattern on their body to blend in, while others just take the more simpler route and bury themselves underneath the sand. But if they are buried under sand, how can they breathe or respire? Well, they have spiracles that are on top of their head, literally just behind their eyes. When the oxygen-rich water is taken in by these, it's then passed over the sensitive gill tissues, where the oxygen will then be removed. This water will then flow out of the body via the gill slits that are on the bottom, or the underside, of the ray. Now, they just don't bury themselves under the sand to hide from predators or to chill out. Stingrays eat a variety of different things. Worms, fishes, crustaceans, clams. That's right, crustaceans and clams, I said. But how does an animal that has no bones eat something that has such a hard exoskeleton? Well, it turns out that they have most powerful jaws that can crush through these. In fact, they'll find them by digging in the sand to actively hunt them out. Because remember, they have the Ampullae of Lorenzini. Now, in the very beginning, I mentioned this really cool animal that you have to see to believe. And that's because, as we know now, sharks and rays are actually related, although have some striking differences, like their pectoral fins. Rays have quite big elongated ones, do they not? However, there is an animal that definitely looks like a solid mix between sharks and rays. Meet the guitarfish. It's in fact a species of ray, but doesn't it look like a shark? I think they are most cool. Do you? Let me know down in the comments below what your favorite species of ray is. Is it a manta ray or the round stingray? Actually, while you're here, you might as well click on the video here, checking out another amazing animal of the deep that has some pretty impressive connections to a Dalek? What? Go on, click it. I'll see you over there. Thanks for watching.